Hello, very good morning to all the students. This is Professor Ronak here, welcomes you all in the class of the financial management. I hope my voice is audible. Shall I move ahead, guys? Thank you so much. Let me share my screen. Here we are. Yesterday we had discussed about one case study, which was basically on the capital structuring exercise. The very famous case study of Reliance, just in 2019 and 20, we got that. Today, I'll take you to some features of the debentures and then I'll take you to the preference shares. Let's go to the debentures. Many of the students might not be very much aware about it. Let me just take you to the features of it. So, friend, in a very layman language, if I tell you, the loan you take from the bank and financial institution, that is in a lump sum amount, right? Say 1 crore of rupees, 2 crores of rupees. But if you want to take a loan from individuals, the person like you and me, you cannot take it in the lump sum, right? Because Chagan Lal's capacity would be different. Ambani's capacity would be different. Every Tom, Dick and Harry will have their own different capacity to invest. They cannot give you 1 crore of rupees of loan. So this 1 crore of rupees may be further divided into various small katke parts. So I'm dividing it in 1 lakh parts. 1 lakh parts. So each part will be 100 rupee. Now I'll tell that, see, I have got 1 lakh units. So based on the capacity, jiski jitni yatha sakti hai, uske hisab se, wo us debenture ke andar invest karega. Someone will have 5 debentures capacity, he or she will invest in 5, someone will have 10, someone will have 15, someone will have 1000, whatever the case it may be. So everyone will invest based on their capacity. So it's basically a loan taken from individuals and various financial corporations in a katke manner. That is the debenture. So just like a promissory note, it's a promise given by a company that we will pay you so and so money after some number of years with this specified interest rate. That is called as the debenture, a loan taken from the public but in a katke manner, in small securities. Now there is one more term which is interchangeably used, is bond. Now both of this, debenture and bonds, carrying the same meaning, but there is a thin line of difference between the two. Word debenture is used more often when these debentures are unsecured, and bonds are always secured. I'm not saying that debentures are always unsecured, but that is a word that is more famous among the investors when those debentures are unsecured, and bonds are basically secured. And bonds are can also be traded in public at large, you know. So there has to be a rating to be done by some credit rating agency. So company will appoint a credit rating agency, and credit rating agency will certify about the company that whether the company is liquid, is good in liquidity, the company is able to manage its funds well, company has got some good amount of cash to repay back this amount to bondholders. So once this certificate is obtained, and bond will be given one ranking, you know, say A++ ranking, B++ ranking. There are various ranking criterias for rating of bonds, and then and accordingly the public will invest in those bonds. So these bonds may be publicly traded. These bonds may not be publicly traded as well. If they are publicly traded, then you can purchase it from your DMAT account as well, right? So Debentures and bonds are basically loan taken by company in a small securities. That's a very fundamental understanding of it. So it accompanies following features. First is the trustee, which is the beach banda, the middleman. Just like a panditji who does the settlement between groom and bride, this trustee does the settlement between the company and the people who are investing in the debentures of company. For people, it's an investment. For company, it's a loan. Now see, debenture holders would be many in numbers, right? If they want to pass on some messages, if they want to communicate some requirements to company, if company wants to pass on some messages to bond holders at large, then there has to be some representative, just like we have the class representative through which you communicate your messages to faculty, to your program coordinator. This trustee works in the similar fashion, called as the beach wala bandha as well. Now, this bond may be secured, may be unsecured. Now, all those bonds which are publicly traded, there is a mandatory requirement for security. That means those bonds are secured by some assets. Assets of the company, obviously. So if the company makes default in making the payment of installments or the repayment of debenture, so at that time assets will be seized or assets may be liquidated and the money may be recovered back from it. So there may be an interest rate or there may be no interest rate at all. So there can be a bond which can be a fixed interest bond, or it may be a floating interest bond as well, variable interest rate option. So some of the bonds issued by the government of India are floating interest bonds, you know, which basically evolves and the rate of the interest gets changed over a period of time based on the repo rate changes. So whatever the repo rate changes are done by the Reserve Bank of India, based on this, some spread margin would be kept, and this interest rate of debenture will also keep on getting changed. It may be a zero interest rate. Then some people will be like, sir, if there is a zero interest rate, then why should I invest in that? See, it is telling you it is a zero interest rate. It does not tell you that it is a zero return bond. You are not there to do service, right? You want to earn some money. So basically, these bonds are issued at discount. So say they are issued at 70 rupees. And once these bonds will be matured after 5 years or seven years, then you will receive 100 rupees. So you are not receiving any interest during that period. But it is just a difference between your issue price and the redemption value. That is what the investors get. They had invested at 70 rupees. At the time of maturity, they get 100 rupees. So 30 rupees is their earning. Though they are not earning any interest, but it is just a difference of issue price and redemption price which they are earning. Can also be called as the discounted bonds. Can be called as the zero interest rate bonds, can be called as the zero coupon bonds as well. Obviously, not every Tom, Dick and Harry can issue this. Companies will have to take various permissions to issue these bonds and debentures. First, they will have to intimate registrar of companies. Then, if they are publicly traded bonds, then Securities and Exchange Board of India's permission needs to be taken. Then the underwriters will be appointed. Just like the equity, the entire process of primary market will take place. So it involves a lot of exercises as well. There comes a maturity and redemption as well, my friend, obviously. There may be irredeemable debentures as well. So irredeemable debentures means they are perpetual in nature. They will never be redeemed. That does not mean that investors will be stuck in these bonds. No, though they are irredeemable, investors will be able to sell it in the open market to other people. Say you do not want to remain invested in this bond, you will be selling it to some other fellow by using the exchanges through your demat account only. But these bonds will never be redeemed by a company. So there is a infinite maturity life of this bond. There are few bonds which are there carrying the infinite number of periods as well. Perpetual bonds, they are also called as the perpetual bonds, or you may call it irredeemable bonds or debentures. Now they basically comes up with a feature called call and put option, you know. Now do not confuse that with the equity call and put function. This has slightly a different context. Call and put feature in the bond is about giving the option to investor or to a company for redemption of the bond. So say if the option is given to an investor, that investor can redeem it even before the maturity period. Say maturity period is 8 years, but if investor opts to redeem it, then he or she can do it within this 8 years period. Then that option is called as the put option. And if the company has got the right to redeem this debenture even before the maturity, if the company agrees to do so, then that option is called as the call option. I am using these words very carefully. This is the option. That does not mean it will mandatorily be exercised. It is an option. Company may do it, company may not do it. If it is option with the company, then it is called as the call option. If that option remains with the debenture holder, then that is called as the put option. Now do not get confused with the equity call and put options, because those derivatives are different. It has a different context, right? So these are the various features of debentures, and the advantages and disadvantages of debentures are same as the loans. It is a fixed obligation. All the advantages, pros and cons you have seen of loan, no, will be applicable over here in the debentures as well. Well, so that's all about the debentures. Let's go to the preference shareholders. We had started last time with that, right? Okay, so it is also called as the hybrid finance. Hybrid. Why hybrid? Because it contains some features of equity and some features of bonds. So what are the features resembling with the equity? One is dividend payable only out of profits. If there will be a profit, then only the preference shareholder would be given a dividend. Otherwise, company may say no. So that feature resembles with equity. Now see how this preference shares actually works, you know. Let me tell you one story of mine. Me and my sister fights a lot about keeping the remote control with us, you know. So when we are watching the TV, she is like, she wants to take the control of remote. I'm like, I want to keep that remote control with me. And we fight a lot. Then our fight reaches to such an extent that my father comes and says, he gets irritated. He just switch off the TV and say, अब किसी को भी टीवी देखना नहीं है, तुम लोगों ने बहुत शोर मचा के रखा है. Now my sister do not have any problem if that TV is switched off. I said, see, you do not have any problem if there is no TV. What was the problem if I was keeping the remote control? But she is like, see, if the TV will be switched on, no, then the remote control will be with her. If it is switched off, then she don't have any problem. Now this is how this preference shares actually works, you know. They are like, तुम अगर इक्विटी को डिविडेंड दे दोगे तो पहले हमें देना है, लेकिन उनको ना दो तो ठीक है, तो हमें भी नहीं चाहिए. So these preference shareholders are like those sisters. So they have got the priority to get the dividend above the equity shareholders, before the equity shareholders. But it may not be mandatorily distributed if the company do not have the profits, sufficient profits. That depends on the type of the preference shares as well. So we'll see those type. The payment of dividend is not obligatory. The preference dividend is not a tax deductible expense. Obviously, it is a dividend, so it is not an interest. Dividend is never taken as an expense. Any money that we distribute to the owners of the company can never be called as an expense. If you can recall your partnership accounts you were doing in your 12th commerce, whenever the partner was getting some money from the firm, it was adjusted in partner's capital account. It was never charged as expense. It was called as drawing. If the partner takes some money from the business, it is a drawing. It is not an expense. Similarly, dividend is the distribution of the profits to its shareholders who are the owners. That's why it is not a tax deductible expense, just like the equity dividend. So it resembles these features of equity. Then it resembles some features of debentures as well, which is a loan, you know. So dividend rate is fixed. Now it's not like equity share ki milega to milega kitna milega kuch malum nahi hai kabhi 5% kabhi 10% kabhi 5 rupaye kabhi 10 rupaye 15 rupaye no inka fixed percentage hai dena hai to itna hi percentage dena hai. There may be a cumulative, there may be a non cumulative. We'll see the part this the types of it just in some time to come. They have a claim prior to equity shareholders. When the assets will be liquidated at the time of shutdown of company, at that time too, preference shareholders have got the priority to get the assets back over the equity shareholders. I have told you this priority order quite a few times, right? So first there will be a secured loans that will be paid from your assets. Then there will be unsecured loans that will be paid from your assets. Then unsecured outsiders liability, maybe your trade creditors, maybe the bills payable or any other current liabilities, which may be unsecured in nature, those everything will be paid unsecured liabilities. Then if the money will be left, then it will be distributed to the preference capital. And now whatever the money will be left will be distributed to the equity capital at the time of liquidation of the company, when company will be shutting down. So this is the priority order. They do not have right to vote. Now, majority of these companies, while issuing the preference shares, do not give the right to vote. But it is not prohibited as per the rules and regulations. So if it is explicitly mentioned in the articles of association of the company, then there may be a voting right given to preference shareholders as well. But as per the general understanding and the generally followed practice by all the companies, preference shareholders do not have the voting right. They cannot vote in the resolutions passed in the annual general meeting of shareholders. Now, earlier, the preference shareholders used to be irredeemable, but nowadays they have Companies Act 2013 has put restriction on the redemption. It must be redeemable debentures. Irredeemable debentures are now prohibited. Now, this particular time frame when I had referred the Companies Act 2013 was 20 years, but it keeps on getting changed, you know. So I have just write the stipulated time as per the Companies Act, not writing the exact 20 years because it may get changed based on the amendments in the Companies Act. So nowadays, the preference shareholders must be redeemable, must be redeemed in a specified number of years. They cannot be perpetual irredeemable in nature. Earlier, they used to be. Okay, so it can be convertible, non-convertible. In convertible as well, it can be mandatorily convertible or optionally convertible. So when I say convertible, that means they may be converted to equity after some time. Once the stipulated period is over, Now, some of the preference shareholders may be mandatorily convertible. Some of the preference shares may be optionally convertible. So yesterday we had seen one case study of Reliance. Now, in that Reliance Jio has issued the optionally convertible preference shares to Reliance. So Reliance, being a holder of those preference shares, may convert it, may not convert it if it is optionally convertible. But if it is mandatorily convertible, then after 5 years, those preference shares will be forcefully converted into equity shares. Then it may be non-convertible as well, that they will never be converted into equity shares. They will remain as preference shares for the lifetime for their redemption period, you know. Just a second, my battery is down, so I'm just putting it on charge. Then, friends, it may be participating or non-participating. Participating means they have got right to participate in the profits of the company. So say they have got 6% of the dividend, say 10%, 5%. But after making the fixed percentage of the dividend to the preference shareholders, if money is left, then the further dividend may be distributed to the preference shareholders from the remaining profits. So they will be called as the participating, participation in the profits. There may be cumulative or non-cumulative. Means if you do not pay the dividend for 1 year, then that unpaid amount of dividend will be accumulated in a one unpaid account, and whenever you will be making the payment to equity shareholders, before that you will have to satisfy the claims of preference shareholders. So it will keep on getting accumulated for all this number of years. You do not pay dividend for 2 years, 2 years preference dividend will be accumulated in some unpaid account. I'm not saying that company will have to mandatorily pay this. But if the company issues the dividend to equity shareholder, then the first claim to receive the dividend is of the preference shareholders. तो पहले उनका क्लियर करो, तब तुम पे करो, तो कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं. दैट जेलस सिस्टर, यू नो, मैं रिमोट रखूंगी, रख तो. ओके, बट कैन नॉट बी इरिडीमेबल नाउ, मस्ट बी रिडीम्ड विद इन अ स्पेसिफाइड टाइम. बट दैट इज अ लेटेस्ट अमेंडमेंट टू प्लेस इन द कंपनीज एक्ट 2013. There were some loopholes with the irredeemable preference shares. You know, people used it for some taxation purposes. तो इनकम टैक्स तो शाना है, मालूम पड़ गया कि ये लोग ने इरेडीमेबल डिबेंचर्स को यूज करना शुरू कर दिया है, तो फिर कंपलसरी कर दिया कि रिडीमेबल ही होने चाहिए. ओके, सो दिस आर द वेरियस फीचर्स ऑफ प्रेफरेंस कैपिटल. लेट्स गो टू द एडवांटेजेस ऑफ इट. नो लीगल ऑब्लिगेशन टू पे द डिविडेंड्स. इन ओनली आउट ऑफ द प्रॉफिट्स द डिविडेंड मे बी पेड. दैट इज द फर्स्ट एडवांटेज. It's the part of net worth, hence it increases the credit worthiness of firm. So my friend, when it comes to a net worth, no, net worth of a company, see, this is how the balance sheet looks like. Here you have got the assets, here you have got the liabilities. Liabilities will include all the loans and borrowings you have taken, all the current liabilities, non-current liabilities, every such sort of a liabilities for which you are supposed to pay the money. And then here comes two aspects. One is your capital, another one is the reserves and surplus, which are the gathered funds. You know, over a period of time, companies have gathered these funds. So this capital and reserves and surplus is regarded as the net worth of company. Now what happens is that there are various financial ratios calculated by taking the net worth of the company. So if some capital forms a part of your net worth, then those financial ratios will be slightly good. But say instead of preference capital, if you take loan, then loan is never a part of the net worth, right? It is the liability. So that's why your net worth will be looking less in the face of the financial statements. Now, there may be a negative impact on the mind of investors. They will feel that, see, net worth, there are various financial ratios, you know, which are calculated by taking net worth as a base. There may be a net worth to asset ratio, sales to net worth ratio. Based on these ratios, people take the investment decisions. So if some capital is forming a part of your net worth, then it is always good for you. Though majority of the features of the preference shareholders are matching with the debentures, they will still be considered as the part of your net worth. Hence, in the mind of the investors, it increases the credit worthiness of the firm. So if the company has eroded its net worth, you know, company is entirely khalas ho gayi hai, sab kuch tha wo bech diya, बहुत खराब सिचुएशन में घूम रही है, तो उस समय पे ज्यादा लोन लोगे तो आपका नेटवर्थ इंप्रूव नहीं होता. लेकिन उस समय पे तुम प्रेफरेंस शेयर्स अगर इश्यू करोगे तो तुम्हारा नेटवर्थ थोड़ा इंप्रूव हो सकता है. नेटवर्थ रेशियो विल स्टार्ट लुकिंग गुड. दिस इज आल्सो कॉल्ड एज द स्ट्रक्चरिंग ऑफ योर बैलेंस शीट. यू नो देयर इज वन कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ इंटरनल रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग इन द अकाउंट वेयर in front of the investors, these adjustments may take place. Say the debenture holders may be converted into preference shares by passing some resolution. So aapka net worth ho gaya, but upar ho gaya. Yeah, company ke fundamentals mein kuch change nahi aa raha hai, lekin aapne net worth mein debentures ko cancel karke preference share diya after passing some resolution. Aapka net worth ho gaya. I'm not saying very process, there will be a various requirements to be satisfied. And increase your financial stability just doing some just in a balance sheet, you know, without fundamental change in your businesses. So that is always capital forms part of your net worth. No voting rights, no dilution of control. You issue preferences, fine. They are anyway not going to get any voting rights. I'm saying that they never be getting voting rights. If company decides to give so, then company may do it. But overwhelming majority of companies comes up with no voting right preferentials. So direct control never takes.
So
no assets are pledged.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Sir, your voice is cracking so much.
Oops, my voice is cracking. Is it happening for all or just for one fellow here? May I have a confirmation from students? Is it cracking for all? Urja is saying she is also not able to get properly. Oops, really sorry. Then there would be some problem in my phone only. Okay, is it coming properly now? Are you all able to hear me properly
yes,
now?
Yes, better now.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oops, so do you require any point I should repeat? Anything you couldn't understand? Well, should I repeat? I'm just showing you that slide. Anywhere you require because of this cracking of voice, you know, if you couldn't hear anything, just let me know. I'll be clarifying that again. Anyone? Really sorry, huh? These technological issues are beyond my control. Okay, fine. No worries. Thank you so much. Now see, try to understand, my friends. I'm there into a last point of this advantages. A very good advantage. You take loans and borrowings, or you take debentures. then majority of these loans and borrowings will be secured in nature, because unsecured loans and borrowings are very, very expensive. Interest rates are sky high, you know. Now, your assets will be utilized to create a charge on it. You take the loan from a bank. That bank will be taking some assets as a security. Those assets are now secured. Then those assets will not be able to be used again for creating another security for further loans. If those assets amount are not sufficient enough, say you have got the asset of 1 lakh rupees and you take the loan of say 1,20,000. So there is a collateral requirement with the bank. You know, there may be a percentage that there has to be a 80% collateral requirement, 100%, 70%. So 1,20,000 rupees of loan you have taken, against which you have the secured asset of 1 lakhs. Now this 1 lakh of assets will not be used again for creating other securities. There may be other charge involved. I'm not going into technicalities of it. But those assets are now secured, right? But friends, if you issue the preference capital, no, then though you have got the fixed dividend to pay, though majority of the features of preference capital are matching with the debentures, you won't have to create a security on your assets, unlike debentures. In debentures and bonds, the security will be created on your assets, though there may be unsecured, but their interest rates would be sky high. So obviously you will opt for unsecured ones, right? Sorry, secured ones. Now, your assets will be occupied while creating the security on that. In the preference shares, your asset will not be occupied for creating the security, but because legally there is no requirement to create a security on asset for the preference shares. So the mortgageable assets, land and building and all other fixed assets you have got will be preserved, you know, will be conserved. You may take a further loan from banks and financial institutions by putting those assets as a security if you take the preference share instead of the borrowings. So in the future, if you will require, say, the further borrowing, those assets are conserved with you. Those assets may be used to create a security to opt the loan from the financial institution. I hope you are able to get my point. So no assets will be pledged, hypothecated or mortgaged for preference capital. Why? Because preference capital is basically the shareholding. Shareholder khud ko hi khud ke assets se pledge nahi karte na. Owner hai wo khud ko hi khud ke assets se pledge nahi karta. Considered to be an owner legally on paper. That's why security requirement is not there. So all the assets that you have conserved may be further used to create or to take further loans and borrowings from the financial institutions. That is the primarily the biggest advantage of the preference capital, unlike the debentures and loans. Then the disadvantage is that it is very expensive as compared to the debt. Very, very expensive, sir. Because see, debt has got a tax benefit. The effective cost of debt is after tax. Say 9% is the interest rate. Then it is not effectively the 9% which you are paying. You are paying after saving some tax. I have told you quite a few number of times that how the interest is getting the tax advantage, right? So post tax interest rate effectively that any company incurs is interest rate multiplied by 1 minus tax rate. So say tax rate is 30%. So I'm just writing 0.09 multiplied by 1 minus 0.3. So 0.09 multiplied by 0.6. Right. So now chak chopan, so you will have 0.054. So it is basically 5.4% that is your effective cost. Because you will be saving some amount of tax as well, no? Because it is charged as an expense in your P&L account. But in the preference capital, if you pay 9% of the dividend, that will be paid after profit after taxes. So there is no tax advantage involved with that. So before tax and after tax, both will be 9%, but after tax cost of debt will be 5.4% only. That is your effective cost of debt, cost of taking the loans and borrowings. So because of the fact that dividend do not get the tax benefit, it will be more expensive as compared to debt. In spite of no obligation to pay the dividend, if not paid, then it can adversely affect the image of firm in capital market. Though preference dividend is not mandatory to be paid, but still if the company will not make the payment of preference dividend, then it will leave some really bad impact in the minds of investors. It is as good as making the default. जिसको तुमने फिक्स कमिटमेंट दे के रखा था 8% 10%, तुम उसको भी अगर रिटर्न नहीं दे पा रहे हो तो तुम हमें क्या रिटर्न दोगे? सो इन्वेस्टर्स मे टेक इट नेगेटिवली. नॉन पेमेंट ऑफ डिविडेंड टू प्रेफरेंस शेयर होल्डर्स मे बी टेकन नेगेटिवली इन द कैपिटल मार्केट्स एंड देयर मे बी एन एडवर्स इंपैक्ट ऑन द इक्विटी प्राइसेस एज वेल. And the last one is preference shareholders have the prior claim on the assets and earning of the firm prior to equity shareholders. So that is again a disadvantage. So we have broadly discussed the advantages and disadvantages of preference capital. May I have any doubts or queries in the chat box if you have got any? Anything where you require a further explanation from my side related to any points of preference shares? Confirmation through the chat box, please. Has everyone got everything till now? Mr. Vishal is saying no doubt. Ms. Nandini is saying clear. Mr. Mohit is giving the confirmation as well. Ms. Devanshi too, good. Ms. Bansi. Others, any queries or anything, please let me know. Mr. Hardik, good. So I'm getting the messages repetitively from few number of students, you know. बाकी सब किधर है पता नहीं, पता नहीं जी कौन सा नशा करते हैं. सर सुबह सुबह आप इतना बढ़ाते हो, क्या करें? बट क्या करें बेटा, रिक्वायरमेंट है तो कॉन्सेप्चुअली भी सीखनी पड़ेगी चीजें. बिफोर वी गो टू एनालिटिकल एंड मैथमेटिकल एस्पेक्ट, द कॉन्सेप्चुअल अंडरस्टैंडिंग इज रिक्वायर्ड एज वेल. देन इट कम्स द इंटरनल अक्रूवल्स. लेट मी जस्ट चेक व्हाट इज द टाइम. 10:32, आई विल बी टेकिंग इट 10 मिनट्स मोर. Okay, so we have got the internal accruals, can also be called as the reserves and surpluses. So my friends, reserves and surpluses are formed by primarily these three components. One is the profits transferred. On a yearly basis, you transfer your profits in the balance sheet. So that accumulates the reserves and surplus amount on a yearly basis. That is also a fund for you, right? Then you have created some reserves for a specific purpose. There are mandatorily some reserves to be created for banking, say companies, for insurance companies, for manufacturing companies as well. Some reserves are mandatory to be created. So those reserves will also be forming a part of it. And then the securities premium. Now, securities premium is basically the extra money you have charged from your preference shareholders, equity shareholders, and debentures holders over and above their face value. So, say the face value of the equity is 100, but the market value at which you have issued that price is 500 rupees. So you have additionally collected 400 rupees from equity share, can also be called as the securities premium. So that also forms a part of your retained earnings. Now, retained earnings cost will be same as the cost of equity, because ultimate right over the retained earnings belongs to the equity shareholders only. Equity shareholders are the real owners of the business. So the right over the reserves and surpluses belongs to the equity shareholders only. So cost of equity will be equal to the cost of reserves and surpluses. So let's go to the advantages of it. A very first advantage, it is readily available. This is the internally generated funds. So whenever, at whatever the situation, in whatever the circumstances, you require this money, you can use it. आपका खुद का पैसा है भैया, किसी से परमिशन लेने की जरूरत नहीं है. नॉट इवन द परमिशन ऑफ द शेयर होल्डर्स इन द एनुअल जनरल मीटिंग. रिजर्व्स एंड सरप्लस कैन बी फ्रीली यूज्ड फॉर द फ्यूचर एक्सपेंशन एंड मेंटेनेंस पर्पस ऑफ द कंपनी. इट बेसिकली रिप्रेजेंट्स द इन्फ्यूजन ऑफ एडिशनल इक्विटी. सो माई फ्रेंड, इन स्टॉक मार्केट there is one very famous ratio called BV ratio. That is a book value ratio. BV matlab, don't interpret in that way. On that, one more ratio is developed, which is price to book value ratio. Price to book value ratio can also be called as the PB ratio. Now I'm coming to that second point. Before that, you should understand this. Now, this price to book value ratio is a sign of valuation of the company, that how your company is valued in comparison to your book value. So the book value of the share is basically the equity capital plus reserves and surpluses, which are the internal funds of the company, divided by the number of shares. This is called as the book value of share. Say the book value of share is 100 rupees. And right now in a market, the price of that particular share is say 400 rupees. Then price to book value ratio is 400 divided by 100. 400 is the actual market price and 100 rupees is the book value. Is 4, right? So I can also say it like the market price is 4 times of your book value price. Now book value is basically a value of share as per the accounting financial statements. Whatever the values you have recorded in your financial statements, based on that each share should be having 100 rupees of value. But share market is carrying the price of 400. Now what could be the potential reasons behind it? Because see, share market is not about the historical performance. Share market is also about the potential performance in the future. People invest with some expectations in the future. Whatever the company has done till now, whatever the reserves and surpluses are gathered till now, whatever the financial position you have kept till now, that is immaterial, because you are investing in a share with some future orientation, right? So there is a possibility that people are expecting a good returns and good profitability in the upcoming years. So that's why they are purchasing the share even at the higher prices than their book values. Now, even though you consider the future potential and everything, you know, after certain extent, it becomes extremely overvalued. So it has been historically observed that all those markets, those who have got more than 5 PB ratio, they were not able to survive at those levels. So if you consider the Nifty, which considers the 50 companies of top 50 companies of India in terms of their market capitalization. So currently the PB ratio of the Nifty is somewhere around 6. I was looking at the data. 6 to 6.2, which is a great overvaluation, can also be a sign of the stock market bubble. Now, historically, in every markets, nationally and internationally, Dow Jones you take, Nasdaq you take, No markets have survived at a PB ratio of more than 5. Now, this 50 companies which are part of the Nifty will take the average of it based on their market capitalization, you know, their weighted average. So you get the average of entire market, say Nifty. So it tells you of various things about whether the stocks are overvalued or undervalued. So if the companies have got good reserves and surpluses, then my friend, the book value will be increased. And if the book value will be increased, then obviously the PB ratio will fall. Because if the denomination increases, then the ratio falls, right? And if the PB ratio falls, then investors may feel that this stock is undervalued and the prices of this stock may get boosted further. So PB ratio is a sign of undervaluation and overvaluation, where the book value is considered into account. Why I'm telling you this is that, see, it's basically the book value of the share basically consists your reserves and surpluses as well. If you take the face value of the share, no, some of the face values of the share are just 10 rupees or 5 rupees or 7 rupees, 10 rupees, 1 rupee. Some of the shares may be at 1 rupee too, or 100 rupees. But those stocks are traded somewhere at 3,000, 4,000. So book value also consists the reserves and surpluses of the company, my friend. What I'm trying to say to all of you is that it is always good for a company if they have got some good reserves and surpluses, because that boosts their book value ratio. And if the book value is increased, then the PB ratio is decreased. And if the PB ratio is decreased, it is a sign of undervaluation. Investors will start investing in that company, which is a very systematic analytical tool for identifying undervaluation and overvaluation. There are various other models as well, but it is one of the simplest ones. There is something called price to earning ratio too. If I tell you one of my personal experiences related to investing based on the book value, you people have heard about the Tata Motors stock. So at the time of Corona, when the entire market got crashed, the PB ratio of the Tata Motors was drastically down. It was somewhere near to 1:1, you know. At one point of time, the Tata Motors stock were traded at 70 rupees. And at that time, I had invested quite heavily in that. And then right now, it is somewhere near to 340, 350 rupees. So you can see just in a 1 year, it has got the jump of 4 to 5 times. So one of the primary reasons behind the jump of the Tata Motors, even though there was no fundamental change that took place in a company, no significant change, that would be a better word, but still the prices got 4 to 5 times multiplication. Why? Because the book value was quite good. And in comparison to a book value, the actual market price was not so good. So in the similar type of the company of industry, the PB ratios were very high. And if you have just got a 1 PB ratio for someone, then it is a sign of undervaluation of that company. And now we have seen that it is at the skyrocketing high prices. Well, so it is basically forming a part of the valuation of the equity. So more and more reserves and surplus, better and better it is for company. No dilution of control. Basically, it is just a money you have gathered. So when you use the reserves and surplus for any of the purposes, the dilution of the control never takes place. Stock market generally views the retained earnings with very positive connotation. If you have got the good reserves and surpluses, it is always considered better among the investors. Amount raised by retained earning may be limited. That is the disadvantage. Obviously, because you have got some limitations to use it, right? The quantum is highly variable because companies typically use the stable dividend policy. and retained earnings gets utilized in the payment of dividend. There are two types of companies. One is the dividend paying companies, another one is the growth companies from the perspective of the investor. Some companies pay a lot of dividend, some company will not pay a good dividend, but they will give you the return in terms of increment in market price. Because more and more reserves and surplus will be there, higher and higher book value will be there, right? And if higher and higher book value will be there, then shareholders will consider the PB ratio. Investors will consider the PB ratio. The PB ratio is very attractive, very less. People will invest into the stocks. So obviously the increment in market price will take place. So if the company do not pay the dividend, and if it is keeping in a reserves and surplus, then the book value get increased, right? And if the book value get increased, ultimately the market price will be increased, because investors are rational enough to identify these opportunities. But what happens sometimes is that some of the industries, if I tell you the IT industry, there is a lot of pressure in giving the dividend to all. Some companies are known for their dividend payouts. People are investing only because they are paying the good amount of dividends. So in that case, the retained earning would be used to pay off the dividend, you know. So that's why company will be left with a very limited amount of retained earning, which may be utilized for their further business expansion. The opportunity cost of retained earning is too high. Now, let me share one more example with you. What is the time there? It's 10:45. Oh my God. Anyway, I'll have taken the 5 minutes of your break. I'll not be sharing. We'll be discussing these two points later on. Fine. That's it from my side. Just put your enrollment number as a mark of your attendance, please. Bye-bye. Take care. Sayonara. If you have any queries or doubt, I'm there with you. You can express your queries or questions to me. Else, you may just disperse from the session. Bye-bye. Take care. Sayonara, guys. See you all in the next session with the utmost energy and enthusiasm. Bye-bye. Thank you.